This is the signal, fanfares for the beginning of the procession with which Her Majesty will depart from the Abbey. The Queen is still in St. Edward's Chapel, where, assisted by the Mistress of the Robes and attended by the Lord Great Chamberlain, she is being arrayed in her robe of purple velvet. And meanwhile, away down the Abbey, under the organ loft, I see the leading members of the procession, the officers of the Orders of Knighthood, in the sweeping robes of their orders, the scarlet satin mantles of the Order of St. Michael and St. George. There's the prelate of the order moving now under the organ screen in his Saxon blue mantle, lined with scarlet silk, and the gentleman usher of the Order of the Thistle in a mantle of green satin, and the chancellor of the Order of the Garter in dark blue velvet lined with white, and the Knight's Grand Cross of the Order of the Bath in crimson silk satin. It's an amazing pattern of colour down below as this glorious procession moves out along the choir, and lining the choir are the Queen's bodyguard of gentlemen-at-arms in their red tunics and blue trousers trimmed with gold, and long plumes of white swan's feathers cascading from their helmets, waiting to escort Her Majesty. And now I see the Knights of the Garter, who held a canopy, wearing their garter mantles, blue over red velvet surcoats, in cloth of silver trunks and doublet, white silk hose, white shoes with silver rosettes, and the blue velvet garter with golden letters, and leading each order of knighthood of the gentlemen ushers of the purple rod, the blue rod, the green rod, and then preparing to move from the right side of the throne are the representatives of Ceylon, South Africa, Australia, Pakistan, New Zealand, Canada, the bearers of the standards, the Union Standard, the Standard of the Principality of Wales, the Royal Standard, the bearers who will take up their standards in the nave beyond the organ screen. Very slowly, the procession is moving out. All around the theatre is a dense mass of colour. Standing in the centre between St. Edward's chair and the throne are the six maids of honour. And behind the representatives and the standard bearers, I see the Prime Minister, Sir Winston Churchill. Behind him, behind the cross, the Archbishop of York. The Archbishop of Canterbury is still in St. Edward's Chapel, though he will join the procession shortly. And then the great mass of the bishops in their seats. And gradually the procession moves from the golden carpet of the theatre, and it is formed on both sides of the throne. The heralds have left their position by the great pillars and taken their appointed places, and now the prime ministers of the members of the Commonwealth are beginning to move, and Sir Winston Churchill turns round as he bears right into the nave for a last look at the high altar, and behind him the Cross of York and the Archbishop of York, and behind him in his wig with a coronet over it, the Lord High Chancellor, wearing a black mantle, gold embroidered. And behind him is borne a purse embroidered with the royal arms. And now Sir Winston Churchill goes down the steps to the nave, and the Earl Marshal is waiting the time when the procession has moved sufficiently for Her Majesty to join it. And soon taking his place will be the Duke of Edinburgh, followed by his midshipman page, coming from the chairs on the left of the theatre. And there I see now the sergeants at arms carrying great gilt maces, and the heralds of Richmond and York, Chester and Lancaster, and gleaming there the blades of the sword spiritual, the sword temporal, Gaetana, the blunt sword of mercy borne by the Duke of Northumberland, the three swords standing ready to move abreast, standing just beyond the gold plate of the Abbey, just beyond the Royal Gallery, where the Queen Mother waits to see her daughter join the procession. And there I see the coronets. I've got a principal king of arms, his coronet fringed with rose, and Narai and Ulster king of arms, Clarencieu king of arms in their tabards, all part of this unimaginable pattern of colour grouped round the rose-red throne with its royal cipher in gold. And now the heralds move into the nave. The procession begins to move forward. The Lord Mayor of London, bearing the crystal scepter, part of it made in Saxon times, and by him the Lord Great Chamberlain, the Lord High Steward of Ireland, the High Constable of Scotland, the Great Steward of Scotland, and interspersed in this long procession, whose head has now reached the west door, I can just see over the organ loft, the standards passing through the west door, and interspersed in the procession of the pages attending peers and peeresses. They're 12 to 15 years old, wearing the livery colours of those they attend, claret or murrey or blue. The royal pages only in scarlet, and all of them in white breeches and stockings, lace cravats and ruffles, and wearing swords. What a day for the pages to remember. And all these wonderful robes and uniforms swirl down below, moving over the golden and the blue carpets, moving round the rose and gold throne, framed by the massed crimson and white of the peers and peeresses, and the blue fabrics moving under the golden royal gallery, where the Queen Mother watches while we all wait to see her daughter proceed towards the west door, towards her people in the London streets. And when Her Majesty emerges from St. Edward's Chapel to form and join the procession, we shall hear the national anthem, and then we shall follow her procession as she departs from the Abbey. Now the Earl Marshal takes up his place, and the fanfares announcing the Queen will sound.